My name is Antonio Ojas-Huecha. I'm a second-year PhD candidate at the University of Twente. My goal is to develop numerical models that can predict how the human body responds and adapts to closed-loop neuromodulation in motor-impaired individuals. In this presentation, I'm going to show you our first step in this direction. The ability of interfacing with alpha motor neurons in the intact human in vivo is central for understanding how human movement is altered with impairment and also for developing neurorehabilitation technologies to restore natural function. Neuromuscular injuries such as spinal cord injury and stroke disrupt neural function in spinal centers, and this results in motor disorders. A possible solution is the use of electrical stimulation of the spinal cord. This can potentially help restore physiological function in neural cells responsible for movement control. Although there are many invasive electrical stimulation techniques, subthreshold transspinal electrical stimulation, also called transcutaneous spinal direct current stimulation, is quickly attracting attention as a clinically viable alternative for neurorehabilitation. Due to its non-invasive nature and ease of application, it could potentially be helpful for a large range of impairments, from spinal cord injury to those impairments where spinal excitability is compromised, such as stroke and cerebral palsy. However, there is still a long way to achieve optimal clinical translation of transspinal electrical stimulation. The main problem is that electrical stimulation is currently applied in a blinded way, with hand-tuned parameters and with no direct knowledge of its effect on motor neuron activity. Also, to infer the effects of transspinal electrical stimulation, current approaches rely on artificially inducing stretch reflex, H reflex, or transcranial magnetic stimulation. This prevents its applicability in real-time scenarios and also optimal personalization to a patient. Our goal is to move towards a closed-loop, non-invasive approach where stimulation parameters can be adjusted on the fly as a function of recorded or estimated neural activity. To do so, we propose a high-resolution framework where we combine transspinal electrical stimulation with high-density EMG and blind source separation to open a window into motor neuron information. If we could do this accurately and in real time, then this would enable developing in the future online corrective feedback for non-invasive neuromodulation that could benefit many people. As a first step in this direction, we recruited 4 incomplete spinal cord injury subjects who perform isometric plantar flexion contractions in 3 different conditions, before, just after, and 30 minutes after stimulation. These subjects underwent both catodal stimulation and sham stimulation as control condition. Within this setting, we recorded high-density EMG from the soleus and gastrocnemius, and by means of convolutive blind source separation, we extracted motor neuron spike trains. The extracted information offers an insight on spinal neural activity. In other words, this allows to interface with the central nervous system directly. In this study, we inferred motor neuron activity across multiple lumbosacral segments of the spinal cord. However, this process is not as straightforward as it seems. Due to inherent noise in the surface EMG signals, first we need to ensure that the decomposed spike trains are physiologically correct, with no errors in the decomposition. Second, we need to extract reliable features that can be sensible to electrical stimulation. If we can do these 2 steps accurately and in real time, then we could have a strong basis for enabling a closed-loop neuromodulation technology that accurately targets alpha motor neurons. Regarding the first point, having an automated algorithm is central for the development of a real-time application. In this work, we are proposing an algorithm that combines 3 indices which are checked with a specific hierarchy. To explain how the algorithm works, let's take the following example of a single contraction from the soleus. In each row, we have a motor neuron discharge pattern with its respective mean discharge rate, and the superposed rate signal is the force. In this case, we decompose 24 motor neurons, but 3 of them may not be physiologically plausible. For instance, if we take a closer look in the first motor neurons, we can see that the yellow one exhibits an abnormal behavior. and it is practically just noise. This motor neuron is then removed by the first quality index, pulse to noise ratio, which measures the quality of the signal. However, these two motor neurons also exhibit abnormal behavior, but this time it cannot be seen with the naked eye. These are detected by the second index, the coefficient of variation of the interspike intervals. And this measure is related with the physiology of the motor neurons of these muscles. As this abnormal behavior might be related to motor impairment, we only remove these two motor neurons if by doing so, the correlation between the estimate of the neural drive and the actual force improves. And this correlation is the third control index. In this example, the blue estimate is before quality control and the red one is after quality control. And for visual purposes, we accounted for the neuromechanical delay. In this example, the correlation improves. But how much did this correlation improve? Across all patients, the improvement was greater for the soleus than for the gastrocnemius. Although the improvement was rather small in the gastrocnemius, the objective here was not to improve the correlation between neural drive and force per se, but to get rid of non-physiological signals without compromising neural information. We then investigated the coherence between cumulative spike trains, and specifically if this varied across stimulation conditions. For each trial, we split the decoded motor neurons into three groups of cumulative spike trains. We detrended them and computed a mean square coherence between them using a wedge program. For statistical purposes, we also computed the Fisher set transformation of the coherence values. And finally, we measured the level of commonality by taking the set transform peaks and areas at the delta band. We focus on the delta band as these low frequencies are associated with force generation, which is especially interesting for motor control and rehabilitation. We computed linear mixed models to analyze the statistical significance of our results. In the figures, we have the set transform coherence peaks and areas of all subjects across time conditions, before, immediately after, and 30 minutes after stimulation. We found evidence of modulation in the catalled condition and no modulation in the sham condition. This modulation is reflected by a decrease in coherence for both peaks and areas after stimulation. So far, we have only looked at how transspinal stimulation changes neural features. The next step is to understand how neural modulation affects the musculoskeletal system too. Namely, in the future, we would like to build causal relations between neural and mechanical levels of human movement under transspinal stimulation. We aim at linking decoded spike trains with a patient-specific musculoskeletal model. For this, we want to discriminate motor unit types based on their individual properties and link them with force generation processes in the musculoskeletal model. To conclude, we proposed a signal-based method to interface with alpha motor neurons by means of blinds of separation, quality control, and coherence estimation. Our results showed that this is a sensitive method for estimating the effects of transspinal electrical stimulation on a motor neuron coherence in four spinal cord injury patients. The relevance is that this method does not require to perturb the body with artificially induced reflexes and is fully non-invasive. In future work, we aim at extending our method to adjust the stimulation parameters on the fly, and this may lead to a closed-loop neuromodulation, which would enable 1. Stimulation patterns to better influence the behavior of neural targets, and 2. A stimulation paradigm that is highly tailored to the needs of each individual patient. This would have a great impact not only to spinal cord injury patients, but also to a large variety of neurological impairments. Thanks a lot for your attention. If you have any doubts, opinions, or curiosities, please do not hesitate to contact me. And well, I'm looking forward to meeting you at the Q&A session.